بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والتين والزيتون وطور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين لقد خلقنا الإنسان في أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات فلهم أجر غير ممنون فما يكذبك بعد بالدين أليس الله بأحكم الحاكمين
Zayd ibn Haritha is from one of the tribes of Yemen. Zayd's mother and Zayd's father were from two different tribes, from the Yemeni tribes. Okay. And these two tribes had a love-hate relationship. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad. One day, Zayd's mother took Zayd, her name was Su'da, took Zayd to her own tribe. And it so happened that a small skirmish broke out right at that time between her husband's tribe and her tribe.
Okay.
So Zayd's extended relatives, some distant uncles and whatnot, they got so angry that they did something very cruel. They took this child, 7-8 years old, they kidnapped him from his own mother, and even though she's a part of their own tribe. But because in Jahiliyyah and even in Islam, the son belongs to the father and the son takes the lineage of the father. So to get revenge at that tribe, they actually, astaghfirullah, stole one of their own sisters, relatively speaking, sisters' children, and that is Zayd, and they kidnapped him, obviously without the knowledge of his mother, and they sold him into slavery. And they sold him to Hakim ibn Hizam. And Hakim ibn Hizam is, of course, the nephew of Khadija. And Khadija had given Hakim money and said, go find a young slave for me, I need a servant at home. And so he becomes Khadija's servant. When Khadija marries the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Khadija gifted this servant to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is way before Islam. Zayd's father is frantically looking for his son, and it so happened that during one of the Hajj seasons, again this all in the days of Jahiliyyah, somebody from that part of the world in Yemen saw Zayd and recognized that his looks are from the tribe of Zayd's father. By asking him some questions, they realized this is Zayd. This is the boy that his father is frantically looking for him. And so when they returned from Hajj, they told Zayd's father, we think we found your son. So the father is overjoyed. He gathers all of the money he possesses. He gets as much money as possible. And the father and the brother, he goes with his brother. They travel to Mecca instantaneously. As soon as they get him out, they travel to Mecca. And so he goes and he approaches the Prophet and he said, Ya Muhammad ibn Abdul Muttalib, he ascribes him to his grandfather, you are of the most noble lineage and Allah has blessed you. And he keeps on praising and praising him. Ya Muhammad, we want to take our son back who was unjustly stolen or kidnapped and sold into slavery. We will give you any ransom you want, but please be generous with us because we can only afford so much. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, is this what you want from me, that I send Zayd back with you? They said, yes, and for whatever price you want, we're prepared to give this price for you. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is up to him. I will leave the matter to him. And if he chooses you, then I will send him back without any ransom. I don't need your money. But if he chooses me, then I can never turn away from somebody who has turned to me. And so they said, oh Muhammad, you have done marvelous. You have done more than we could have asked for. And so the Prophet ﷺ called Zayd. And we can imagine Zayd was probably around 25 years old at the time, roughly. So he's grown up. When he was kidnapped, he was 7-8. He was just a child. So the Prophet ﷺ asked Zayd, do you recognize these two men? And Zayd said, yes, I do. This is my father and this is my uncle. I recognize them. So the Prophet ﷺ said, they have come requesting that you go back with them. And I have left the matter to you. If you want, you may go back with your father and your uncle. And if you want, you may remain with me. Instantaneously, Zayd says, I can never choose anyone over you, for you are to me more than a father and an uncle combined. SubhanAllah. Zayd's father stood up and he says, Haritha, and he says, oh Zayd, have you gone crazy? Have you gone mad? You will choose to be a slave in a strange land and you refuse to come back with your own father to your own tribe? And Zayd remarks for him, yes, I have made my choice. I know what I have said, and I have seen from this man that which I cannot choose anyone over him. And when Zayd said this, the Prophet ﷺ stood up, took him by the hand, and went to this hijr that we just talked about, the open part of the Kaaba, and he stood there and he made an announcement. That's where you made the announcements. And he said, O people of Mecca, I want you all to testify that from now on, Zayd is a free man and I have adopted him as my son. So he is now my son and he will inherit from me and I will inherit from him. And so he became known as Zayd ibn Muhammad. And he did this in front of the father in order to bring some peace to the father's heart. That look, your son is no longer a slave and I will adopt him and I will take care of him and he will inherit from me and I'm the grandson of Abdul Muttalib. Ibn Umar said, we never knew of Zayd by any other name except Zayd ibn Muhammad. That's what I thought he was until Allah revealed Surah Ahzab verse 5. Way later on, 30 years after this incident happened, right? And in Surah Ahzab verse 5, what does Allah say? Udu'uhum li'aba'ihim huwa aqsatu 'inda Allah. Call children by their fathers. That is what is noble in the eyes of Allah. And so that was when the Prophet ﷺ rechanged the name of Zayd and he said this is now Zayd ibn Haritha and not Zayd ibn Muhammad. Zayd is one of those few people who it has been said were the first to accept Islam. It is enough of a blessing for Zayd ibn Haritha that he is the only companion ever whom Allah mentions by name in the Quran.
One of the great teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to those who were nearest to him. And I want you to consider, could you imagine if the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam felt weak or if she was unwell? And Fatima Zahra radiallahu anha, you know, she is the most beloved of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's children. She was the only one who lived past his life sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she was, you know, a central focus in his life. So this daughter of his sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Az-Zahra, the flower of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she came to a point where she felt weakness. She had given birth to Al-Hasan, then Al-Husayn, and she just didn't recover. She was unwell in different capacities. So she spoke to Aisha sometimes, and she spoke to Ali radiallahu anhu. So she says to her husband, listen, can you ask sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to maybe send for me somebody to help me? I can't keep up with what I'm doing. You know, I'm milling the wheat and I'm cooking and looking after the kids and my health is not well. So Ali radiallahu anhu, he says, I went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and I said to him, O Messenger of Allah, you know, it is the request of your daughter, my request as well, that if you could ask somebody who can help us. We can't afford a servant, we don't have anything like that. But if there's somebody that you feel that you can say, would you be able to help my daughter? Everybody would love to do this because you are the Messenger of Allah and she is your daughter, O Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now I want you to understand the rank of Fatima radiallahu anha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam puts her as one of those four women who have completed their relationship with Allah. Maryam ibnat Imran, Asiya the wife of Fir'aun, Khadija bint Khuwaylid, wa Fatima bint Muhammad, completed in her ascent, in her relationship with Allah. And yet the Prophet ﷺ, he says, I'm not going to send you a servant, I'm not going to ask anyone for this, I'm going to teach you something better that will give you strength in your body and vigor whenever you ask Allah for it. Subhanallah. This is a prophetic protection that you and I need, prescribed for his daughter, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's better than you and I and more dear and beloved to him. So Ali radiallahu anhu said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. So the Prophet came and visited them in their home. And there's one narration of these narrations. This hadith is muttafaqun alayh, agreed upon. It's found in many of the books of hadith. In one narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came and they had already reclined in their bed, ala sarir, on their sarir. So the Prophet sat between them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were facing him and their feet extended towards him and his feet extended towards them. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sat between them and, you know, he would give them counsel. And in one of these, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا أَوَيْتُمْ إِلَى when you come to your bed and you have sat in it, you khalas, your day has come to an end, you're in your bed, this is the last of the dua you should make, the last thing you should do. So you should say, كَبِّرُوا ثَلَاثًا وَثَلَاثِينَ, that you should say 33 times, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. وَسَبِّحُ ثَلَاثًا وَثَلَاثِينَ. Say Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah 33 times and make Hamd, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah 33 times. This is the narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In another narration, he said that you should make your Tasbih 34 times. In another narration, it's make your Takbir 34 times. So in one riwayah, he said Allahu Akbar 34 times. In another riwayah, it's Subhanallah 34 times. All of them are good. It totals up to 100. There's also another narration which you and I are familiar with, that after every salah that we say Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah 33 times, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah 33 times, Wallahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar 33 times, and we conclude it with لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير, which builds for us a house in Jannah. This is a very similar prescribed medicine from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So make it a ritual in my life and your life that when we sit in our bed, Allahu Akbar 34 times, Subhanallah 33 times, Walhamdulillah 33 times. Make that a regular ritual in our household. If you wish to follow the other narration, which is Allahu Akbar 33 times, Subhanallah 34 times, and Alhamdulillah 33 times. It is a prophetic medicine described and prescribed for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What will this do in my life and your life? It will give you strength of body and vigor and health that was not there had you not made this dua. Meaning that your restful sleep, and this is a dua, this is an invocation for those who find themselves with insomnia. So if you're laying and tossing and turning in bed, you don't count sheep, you count your tasbih and your tahmid and your takbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if it didn't finish by the end of it, repeat it once again and maybe do it with another cycle of 34 subhanallah or 34 Allahu Akbar. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a restful sleep. وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا. It is meant for repose and comfort. May Allah comfort us in it through this prophetic protection of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ وَسَلِّمْ وَزِدْ وَبَارِكْ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Ramadan TV. As we know, the recent COVID-19 outbreak has affected many people locally and globally. But what it also has done is it's given us an opportunity to bring out the good in people, and that generally is the nature of fitna or tests. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends us these tests to bring out the true nature of ourselves. One organization that has been on the ground from day one is Human Appeal International, providing relief and help to those vulnerable and less fortunate in the community. And I'm joined with me today is Ali Kadir, the State Manager of Human Appeal South Australia. Ali, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam, Dawood.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah, and thank you for having me.
That's
here
okay.
Today.
No problem, no problem. So Ali, tell us a little bit about what Human Appeal International has been doing in response to the COVID-19 outbreak.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. First of all, thank you, Dawood, for the opportunity here. As we all know, it's now been a few weeks now since the outbreak of the coronavirus here locally and across the globe. So from the beginning, we kind of sensed a little bit about how deadly this virus could be. And obviously in the course of the last few weeks, this really took its toll and had the biggest effect onto all community here and across the globe. And in particular with the lockdowns or the partial lockdown to certain people. So one of the things that we introduced from the beginning of the outbreak is a project to help the vulnerable within our community and of course across the globe as well, yep, because we are an international organization. Mm-hmm. But in particular, we did this project to help the vulnerable to remain indoors. And that was almost less than 24 hours after the announcement of the Prime Minister for the vulnerable to be on self-isolation, yep, or lockdown. Yep. So what we introduced, a parcel, which is basically a food, an essential parcel that that includes all your staple food items and your hygiene kits to be delivered to the vulnerable within our community.
That's fantastic, that's fantastic. And as you said, The elderly have been very, very affected by this. As we know, there are restrictions on what time they can go shopping. And, you know, just with things like this, I think it's just caught everyone by surprise. So have you found that there's been a lot of support with the hamper or the food package campaign from other individuals or other organizations that have jumped on board and helped to sponsor the project?
Yeah, absolutely, Dawood. Look, this project here itself, it's actually quite a big project. So it's not something that it's, and it's got many challenges related to it. So the biggest challenge we found at the beginning was when people were hoarding the food. So they're going to the supermarkets and everyone is really buying a large amount of quantities of everything and storing this stuff. So obviously that led to many shortages within the supermarket. And that was quite difficult for the elderly, for the seniors in particular, because most of the time, them being the most vulnerable one, and we know the ones that lost their life the most were the seniors within the different communities.
Definitely.
So what we wanted to do is with this one here, the challenges, the biggest challenge we had was to actually skewer the goods, which at that time was very, very challenging for us. And on top of that, skewering the funds, because when it comes down to emergency, Human Appeal International Australia does not wait for the donations to come to act on it.
Right.
We always prioritize at the time of emergency to make sure that we will fulfill, we will do a campaign to help the community, and then we obviously approach the community for their support.
MashaAllah, that's very good. And as we just mentioned, a lot of people have been affected by it. We can't really say that there's one particular age group or category that have been affected by the COVID-19. People are losing their jobs. People are struggling to put food on the table. So apart from the elderly, are there any other factions or people within the community that have also been affected and Human Appeal has been able to help with the help of other organizations as well?
That's a very good question, because, and I think if you ask anyone in relation to the effect that this virus had on individuals or families or in as a global effect, it has had a humongous effect, huge effect to almost every family has been affected by it in one way or another. So what we found, there are also different categories of people that have been heavily hit with this virus as well, and it has affected them in a very hard way, which are the international students and your skilled migrants. So this project itself is now has rolled on to support the international students and the skilled migrants.
That's
as well.
That's amazing, mashallah. Yeah. That's amazing. And as we know, Islamically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى, to collaborate, to cooperate in matters that are going to help other people, in matters of righteousness. And it's really beautiful to see that Human Appeal International and many other organizations have joined hands, have collaborated for a greater good. And as a result of this, what kind of response have you received from the people that have just been sitting at home? They've got a knock on the door and all of a sudden they've got a box of food at their doorstep. Like, what kind of response? I can imagine that it would be absolutely heartwarming.
It would be, because I think one thing that I need to cover before answering that question would be, how do we get the contact of these people?
Right.
So how do we know who's vulnerable, who needs the support?
Yeah.
So when we launched this project here, the first thing we did before we deliver anything out, we actually partnered with many of the councils around South Australia and with many organizations and communities, and including the Indigenous community as well. So we had a very wide approach. And the agreement that we had with them was to, for them to connect with their community, to approach their community and find the vulnerable within the community. So if we take the council as a perspective, so the council took the responsibility of individually calling all the seniors within their council, number one, to check up on them, number two, to find out if they had any support to help them to keep them indoors. So for example, one of the questions would have been asked, do you have anyone to do the grocery shopping for you? So if the answer was to be no, what that would have meant for that individual, for that senior family or a person, would have meant that he would have had to, or she would have had to go out themselves to the shopping in that at that time, which was quite
risky
time. And that's one aspect. The second aspect was finding the goods that they need, because most of the aisles were empty at that time. Even still now, we're seeing a lot of the aisles still empty. So hence, they would have been the ones that we will get the information from the council sent back to us on a daily basis. And we are still getting on a daily basis. Yeah. Like for example, yesterday alone, we had 22 students, list of 22 students that came to us. So this is continuing on. And that's how we had a very valuable, accurate data that was coming to us to help them. And the response that we would get from these people were truly in desperate need of these goods. So when they're getting a parcel that has all their staple food, and by the way, when we say staple food, this is enough for a couple for at least 2 weeks and for an individual for about a month.
Yeah.
So, and on top of that, we added the hygiene kit, and the hygiene kit included, of course, your toilet papers, which was, you know, even still now people find it challenging to find it, but toothpaste and so on. So this is all included in there. Mm. And in many cases, you know, we had people calling us angels, people, you know, like the people with, because they haven't seen anything like it. Right. We're getting overwhelming response from them emailing or calling or messaging us saying thank you for this huge support that they were not expected, that they weren't expecting such things, and the overwhelming, you know, parcel size getting delivered to them was definitely a big relief for them.
Yeah, definitely. And I think, you know, speaking for myself personally, we kind of, in this kind of society, we live in a bubble. I mean, it's very, we do watch the news, we do see the negative impacts of COVID-19, the coronavirus, but you know, as long as the fridge is full for us and we've got food to put on the table for the family, we would never ever think that locally in Adelaide there would be people that can't get out and do the groceries or that don't have enough money to buy food, you know, simple staple items for their household. I mean, we would never think that until you're actually on the ground engaging with the community, asking them for their needs, what they need. You'd never think that, would you?
No, and I think sometimes, you know, until now, every now and then I get a question from people within our community and other communities telling us, do they really need this? My answer to them is, and all the time is, have you seen, have you visited, yeah, have you checked on our community? You will be surprised how much need is out there within our community, even if we look at it locally in Adelaide, being a small community, let alone in across South Australia, across Australia and across the globe as well. We had council calling us saying there's a lady on the phone crying, she can't have access, she doesn't have toilet paper, so she's crying for a simple thing as a toilet paper. People were telling us, where they're saying that if you wouldn't have delivered this, I wouldn't have had nothing to eat. We have families that we delivered to within our own community that they have kids. They are students that have come here and they've lost their job as a husband and wife. They have kids. And honestly, they didn't even have food to put on the table for their own family. This is happening right here in Adelaide. So these are the people that we are really approaching and helping. And I have to say, this is not the end of it. We are right at the beginning of it, and it's going to be a lot more of that within our community. So it's definitely something that we shouldn't be, you know, overlooking at this and thinking that we live here, it's okay. There are a lot of vulnerable people within our community.
Definitely. And for the viewers watching at home, I think it really should promote a response of action. Many people are watching saying, okay, I've realized the gravity of this situation. What can I do to help?
Look, we deliver hundreds of these parcels, and these parcels sometimes estimated cost about $120, up to $120. We're putting more and more stuff in there for them to keep them. It's not something, even though this is something still, it's not a huge thing, but it's giving them food for about a month or 3 weeks. So the more we can give them, the more we can protect them. And we're hoping that as days go along, things kind of get a little bit better, or the aid kind of proportion kind of expands as well, so we can help more people. So from aid perspective and from involvement perspective, the biggest need that we need is their generous donation. This is where not only in Australia we are doing so much and we need your support, but the biggest thing that I would like to touch upon is that we still have a huge crisis that we have across the globe that we are working so hard to help them during this, you know, blessed month of Ramadan. We're still, so many countries are still in lockdown. Bear in mind, they have no support whatsoever. A lot of them rely on themselves. So if they don't have the ability to go outside to earn their living, they basically cannot get anything. That means the whole family is now on pause of any funds to support themselves and put a meal on the table.
That's right.
So this aid here, what we're encouraging the communities right now is basically that this is a month of giving. Month of Ramadan, it's a blessed month. This is where the Prophet ﷺ was the most generous in Ramadan. This is the time where not only the poor and the ones that are in refugee camps have been affected by it, we're getting reports that are people jumping into the bin, like the outside bins, and going through them to get some food for their own family and themselves. This is a very tough time where it has hit everybody. So if we all do something, it's definitely, you know, it will reduce, you know, I mean, the effect or the horrific effect of this coronavirus that has passed on to many people.
Most definitely, and I think that's a really good way to lead into the next part of our discussion. We know that this is happening in Australia, in Adelaide, in our own backyard, so to speak. But also third world countries around the world are also being affected by the coronavirus situation. What's Human Appeal doing about that?
So we are working in 29 countries this Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, we have team across the globe that working through. Sadly enough, it's almost like the crisis, it doesn't get lighter. Almost every year we feel the weight of the responsibility that we have as an ummah, as a community, as an organization is getting bigger and bigger. And as I was mentioning, the effect of coronavirus to the community has been very heavy. Mm. In particular, the developing countries are really dealing with it in a very hard way. It has affected them economically and on individual level as well. So we are getting very heartbreaking reports of the trauma that these people are going through. In particular now, we're looking, aiding these people to put food on the table in this very horrible time. And it's getting on a bigger scale. It's no longer that small group. It's now actually affecting countries at large.
From an Islamic perspective, this is obviously a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator. And one of the wisdoms of being tested is that it brings out the true nature in people. So right now we're seeing a lot of people that are hoarding, refusing to share simple things like toilet paper. But at the same time, we have beautiful initiatives that are popping up. And as you mentioned, Ramadan is knocking on our door. And one of the wisdoms of Ramadan is it helps us to experience what it's like to not have food. That's one of the wisdoms, most definitely. So having said that, I'm sitting at home, I'm watching this, the month of Ramadan is coming up. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most generous. Allah Azza wa Jal, the Creator, He multiplies your rewards in this month. What can we do to help our brothers and sisters in faith and in humanity around the world as I'm watching this at home?
As I was mentioning, Dawood, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was the most generous in Ramadan. And this is something that we can take a step back and really understand what that means, that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was the most generous in Ramadan. So that means you could be, as a watcher, you could be a very generous person. But this is the time where you go one step further. You take another extra milestone where you could be the most generous. Because that was the character of the Prophet ﷺ. And we all know the reward of donation and helping others during Ramadan. The reward of good deed in Ramadan is multiplied. So this is the best time for us to help them. And in particular, when themselves, the poor and needy across the globe, themselves thinking that they're not gonna get help because everyone's in lockdown. This is the time where we can give them some hope. This is the time where we can change things for better, for good. The best thing I can probably suggest with, you know, talking about this one here, we're talking about Ramadan. We're talking about doing good in Ramadan.
Once in a year.
Once in a year.
30 days.
And Ramadan, we restrain ourselves from eating.
Yes.
So why don't we turn that into an amazing work, into an amazing deed, where we can actually, we refrain ourselves from eating in Ramadan. We give zakat al-fitr, because in food for the needy, and at the same time, being right at the beginning of Ramadan right now, what we can do is if every family between themselves was to do 4 or 5 parcels of food for a needy family overseas, how much difference can we make all together? That's a food. That means they're going to eat the whole Ramadan. They're going to eat food and you're getting the reward for it.
SubhanAllah.
That would be amazing. And this is the first step we can do as a community together. Muslims, non-Muslim, anyone that is listening right now, that's what they should be doing. This is an investment that they can do straight away to go online to humanappeal.org.au. That's humanappeal.org.au. Create an account and really just donate for a few food parcels. That will be the beginning that you would
do. And honestly, what does it take? A few hundred dollars. Or even if that one food parcel, like you said, that one food parcel that feeds a family, they've been fasting the whole day. They raise their hands and they make dua for someone that they don't even know who the donor is. But we're reminded by a verse in the Quran, وَمَا تُقَدِّمُوا لِأَنفُسِكُمْ مِنْ خَيْرٍ تَجِدُوهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ Whatever good you put forward, whether it's $10, $20, $15, $30, that one box, Allah Azza wa Jal has recorded it for you.
And it's an investment we are doing, and an investment. Most of us wouldn't even remember we ate yesterday. But this is something that if we put together, not only that we're bringing happiness, we alleviating a very hardship, a huge hardship on a family, on a needy family. Mm. At the same time, we are accumulating some really good deeds that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would know and reward us for on the Day of Judgment. This is the importance of sadaqah. And Aisha radiallahu anha used to perfume her sadaqah because she used to say, this is, I'm giving this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
It will reach Allah before it reaches the people. Subhanallah.
So, you know what I mean? So she's purifying, she is beautifying what she is giving because this is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How beautiful is it that if we can all teach this to our children as a family, come together, alleviate the hardship of a family. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us. Through all these hardships that we went through, everyone still has, you know, something. We have an amazing community supporting each other. Look at all, we've delivered hundreds of parcels.
That's right.
You know, amazing. This is all going out to people. We are here. They don't have that.
And I think something we really don't appreciate with everything that's going on in the world, there's so much khair in the ummah. There's so much good in the ummah. Subhanallah. Now, Ali, that's what we can do globally. What can we do in our own backyard? What can we do for our neighbours, our community, the people in Adelaide, the people in Australia? We know that Human Appeal is running this campaign of food parcels. How can we help out locally?
So to finish off, Dawood, I really want to emphasise on the project locally as well, that we're doing it. If yourself or anyone that you know are going through a hardship, and if you have elderly seniors that don't have anyone to support them, we are more than happy to assist them. This is why we're here. Once again, you can go and register online. If you go to humanappeal.org.au, you can actually register if you need assistance from us. And there are different categories in there. Within these categories are the elderly, the international students, that self-funded ones. And obviously, we've got the skilled migrants that they come in on their own. And that's basically for us doing here and overseas. And I have to say, we cannot do any of this stuff yet without the support of our beautiful community and amazing community and the donors that we have across Australia that always put their hands together. They're the ones that are making all that difference. Consider us as a bridge. We are the bridge between you and the needy. So let us cross this bridge and make this a bridge of hope and goodness so we can really help the less fortunate one. And just before we close off, I would like to just remind myself and everyone else, because of the restrictions that we have, this is a time where we can connect with family and friends.
Absolutely.
This is a time where we can remind each other about the importance of sadaqah and caring for the less fortunate ones. So I suggest to everyone out there, even though that you may not be able to get together as a family to have dinners, iftars together,
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. أشهد
What you can do is pick up the phone if you have children, adult children, where you can speak to them, or if you have friends or family members or cousins and so on, contact them and really initiate a fundraising between yourself for a particular project. You can do a water well, you can do food parcels, you can do medical aid, you can do so many things.
The list goes on.
If you go to our website, you can find all the stuff there, and then you can be part of a really good change that we can all do during this month of Ramadan. So you can not only yourself, but you are being a reason that everyone else can do goodness, and you will get the reward of everything that they're doing without anything reducing from them.
Jazakallah khair, Ali. May Allah, the Creator, reward you generously. I would shake your hand, but obviously I can't now. It was a very, very fruitful conversation. I've definitely taken a lot from it, and I'm sure that the viewers have as well.
Inshallah.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless everyone's Ramadan.
Ameen.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum.